I was born on June the 2nd, 1949, in the city of Chester. Chester in those days was probably very different from today. In those days, it was very much the county town of Chester and also the gateway to North Wales, which was a great playground for us when we were young kids. My mother was Pamela Joyce Morgan, that was her maiden name. And my father was Patrick Robert John Arnold. My mother was born in Chester. My maternal grandfather was from London originally, and my maternal grandmother was from County Fermanagh in what's now Northern Ireland. But my father, he'd been essentially brought up in a sort of combination of London and Ireland, although technically he was born in Liverpool. One of our great memories of living in Chester, and both when we were there and later when we moved to London and returned to Chester for holidays, was the base it gave us for exploring North Wales. And that meant, for us anyway, firstly climbing mountains. The other great playground for us was castles, and we used to love running all over the battlements of the castles when we were young. When I was just over 2 years old, 2 to 2.5 years old, I think, my immediate younger brother, Christopher, who we knew as Squeak, he'd been born as well in Chester. And my father essentially got a promotion to a very good new job in London, based in Isleworth. That was an opportunity we couldn't turn down, much as I know that my parents both loved Chester as a place to live. Very early on in my life, that was a life changer. I was the eldest of what ultimately became five siblings. My younger brothers were Christopher, who we knew as Squeak, and Tony, who we know as Nip, born in 1954. Timmy, who sadly passed away only aged 15 months, was born in 1957. And the youngest of my brothers, Jeremy, was born in 1959. My father was, on a day-to-day basis, a little bit remote. He was developing his own career, probably in the 1950s, newly back in London, big job. So probably closer to my mother at home in those early days when we had the au pairs as well, and very often we'd all go out together. We had a lot of parks to visit in Twickenham, where we were living. Richmond Park was on our doorstep. So that also became a great, great playground for us. My relationship with my mother was, I guess it became gradually less close because I was, being the eldest, I was, attention drifted from successive younger brothers, which gave me probably a level of early independence, which I probably never entirely lost. So my early teenage years, and even before being a teenager, I would run to the end of the garden and look out and started being what they rather demeaningly called train spotters. I would call them railway enthusiasts. So we used to watch all the different engines going past and tick them off as to whether they were something we hadn't seen before or whatever.
And two shots of Princess Coronation number 46240, City of Coventry, at the same location near Coventry on consecutive days.
I actually started travelling around. I had one or two friends of mine who were also interested, and we would travel at a very young age. I think probably we were 11 or 12 when we first started travelling. In those days, people didn't bat an eyelid about young children travelling alone. And we went from right across North Wales, I can remember, with a friend of mine, going to different locations, trying to find out, travelling on old railway lines and chasing after trains. No doubt the most painful experience of my childhood was the loss of the fourth of us siblings, Timothy. We know him as Timmy, who died when he was 15 months old. And that was a very disruptive, ultimately traumatic period for us all. And even though I knew he was seriously ill, it was only in almost the very last days of his life that I had an inkling that he might not survive. And I think that was my first face to face with the experience of mortality and what that meant. Vivid memories to this day of what occurred during those months, I guess, of difficulty and what followed behind and the enormous pressures that put onto my parents. There were three phases to my schooling, if you like, a pre-prep school, which I started at the age of four, known as Brook House, it was called in Twickenham. No longer exists, I think it's a block of flats. And in 57, I went to a school known as the Mall, also in Twickenham, which still exists today. And that was a feeder school to many leading public schools, particularly in southern England, including St Paul's, which was where my parents had put me down for, and following the footsteps of my father and all his brothers, and I had an elder cousin who was already at St Paul's. I was at school in the 1960s, the decade of sex, drugs and rock and roll, and I won't confess to which or any of those that I indulged in. Nevertheless, it was a very exciting period to be in. It was an exciting period of emerging new cultures in the area of music, drama, and of course, ultimately, end of that decade, politics as well.
London. Some estimates put the figure as high as 100,000, others much less. But the anti-war in Vietnam demonstration was a massive magnet which drew protesters from all over the country.
Surprisingly, you might think, we rubbed very close shoulders with the Beatles in the early 1960s. During my absences from the home at school, the Beatles were making their two full-length feature films, Help and A Hard Day's Night, and they were literally shooting in our front garden and out in the street immediately in front of our house. The end of our road was cordoned off, literally cordoned off by the police, and I had to weave my way through a sort of 10 deep phalanx of screaming teenage schoolgirls. And you could hear the screams from a mile away. And invariably the Fab Four were sitting around in the street in front of the house. In 1965, my father made what turned out to be an absolutely life-changing decision, which was to accept a secondment to the University of Malaysia in Kuala Lumpur to be effectively the director of the brand new teaching hospital that was being established there, and was being established with a substantial amount of British aid. It was, to me, an extremely exciting opportunity, and even though I'd be still continuing at school in England, there are going to be opportunities for me to travel during the school holidays to remote and exotic places that previously were just in my imagination and nothing more. It was sort of like a David Attenborough TV programme coming true as far as I was concerned as a mid-teenager. Very early on in my very first visit to KL, which would have been December 1965, it wasn't long after that that I met Gillian at a swimming pool in what was known as, and still is known as, the Lake Club in KL. I was a very keen swimmer in those days. Gillian was a very keen swimmer, and I was doing my laps and she was bouncing off the springboard. And inevitably, we got to talking, and there was nothing much more going on than that for familiarity in that environment. But in subsequent visits, we got to know each other much better, and the rest is history. But when Gillian and I first met, I was only 16, and she was 15. So technically, if not even of age, I suppose, as the saying goes. I think I would have liked to have communicated with her during the absence when I went back to school, but we didn't exchange addresses, and when it came to leave and say goodbye, she was nowhere around. And essentially I went back to school for what was 6 months, and I wasn't even sure where to contact her. I had no number or address to, but lo and behold, I was back in the Lake Club doing my laps, and Gillian was once again on that diving board. And we got talking again, and we decided to do other thing. We discovered then rather than initially that she also had some love of tennis, which I was keen on. My parents were both very keen tennis players. So we started playing tennis together as well as swimming. One thing led to another. I got to know her family, was invited back to the home, and her father was a very keen tennis player of national and international standing. Gillian finished her education in the UK and then went on to a not very successful period at Art College, but she went on to qualify as a nurse. While I'd been at university in Leeds, she used to commute up to see me in Leeds, and we decided we wanted to get together and live together in London. And she explored that with the General Nursing Council, I suppose, who controlled her as a student nurse, and found the only way to do that was to get married. Otherwise, permission wouldn't be granted. I guess because of the practicalities of needing to move to London, it wasn't quite, when it popped the question, it wasn't quite as romantic as it might have been. But we both wanted to do it, there's no question about that. We were married in Isleworth on October the 28th, 1972. The wedding day itself was a DIY wedding, if there was ever a DIY wedding. I think it was, together with a few of my own savings, we had £130 to do the entire thing, which was included paying fees to the church for the actual service, having a reception, Gillian's wedding dress, the car, the whole thing. We managed to get a bottle of champagne for every single guest we had, which took up about 25% of the £130. At least in my day, you got a salary that you was just about enough to live off in London. Gillian was even earning less than I was. And we found a flat in South Woodford in the northeast London on the edge of Essex, which suited us both. I was working in the city, Gillian was at the London Hospital in Whitechapel in the East End. It was a nice commute. We moved from South Woodford to Twickenham, which would then have been much closer to my parents. By that time, Alex, our first son, had been born in June 1978. So he was an infant running around. And although we were technically in the same city as my parents, traveling across from northeast London to southwest London, where they still were in Twickenham, meant that they hardly ever saw their first and at that time only grandchild. So for their sake and our sakes as well, we decided to make that move to Twickenham. But in the meantime, earlier in that year, well, I had approached the office for the possibility of a transfer overseas, and particularly to Asia. And that came about because the winter of 1978-79 went down in history as the so-called winter of discontent. It was the end of the then Labour government, and they had become pawns in the hands of the unions. People of our age then felt there was no future in the UK whatsoever and any way of getting out of it, especially during that winter. And it was a very tough winter as well as having to survive the strikes. The IRA was very active at that time, so you commonly delayed going home, coming to work or from work because of bomb scares. And it wasn't just bomb scares, actual bombs were going off all around London at that time. I just felt this was no way to and a happily developed married life and have a growing family. So I put in for a transfer. But tell me, where do the children play? No sooner had we moved house in Twickenham, I was called in early in the morning by our HR manager, who asked me, did I remember, do I recall that I applied for a job in Asia, sort of 6 or 8 months earlier, whatever it was. I said, yes. He said, well, Singapore have just contacted me, and they are desperate to send a couple of people over from London, and your profile fits exactly what they want. And so I went home, discussed it with Gillian. I'm not sure, even though I went back the next day and said yes, but the short of it was, the answer was yes, after a lot of introspection and deep thought about whether this was something we really wanted to do or we'd moved on from thoughts like that. Gillian, by that time, had been in the UK herself over a decade and had become fairly used to life, but she'd lost almost all physical contact with her family. All her siblings were in Asia. So the opportunity of going back to Asia was obviously a big plus from her point of view in terms of family. So the opportunity was there in Singapore for the family to grow, and David, our second son, was born in Singapore in 1981 while we were still there. Even in his early days, David showed that he was physically exuberant, perhaps not quite as physically exuberant as Alex, but to try and keep David in his cot was a major challenge, and if you turned your back on him, he was probably less than 6 months old, he could jump out of his cot. Both of them were highly physically active, if not reckless daredevils. Amongst, I can remember when we were still living in South Woodford, a neighbour of ours was DIYing the painting of the outside of his house, quite a tall two-storey house opposite our house, and he'd left his step ladders up, leaning against the house, right going to the top. We turned our backs and Alex had gone across the road and was standing at the top of the step ladders, aged about 14 months. So towards the end of 1983, events moved quite quickly. The firm, they were given the task of establishing an office in Jakarta. I was offered the opportunity to go to Jakarta, and my route to being a partner was going to be much quicker if I accepted the transfer to Jakarta. Jakarta itself, to me, was exciting. If you'd asked me way back in London, back in the early days of 1979, when I first went to the office there to ask for a transfer, if my first choice then would have been Indonesia. There was always had a sort of magical allure and mystery about it, going back to probably my first days in Singapore and Malaysia. Indonesia was never the easiest place to live in. And certainly in the 1980s, when we first went there, Indonesia was very much a third world country. Television comprised of one government-controlled TV channel that was all in the local language.
Selamat malam. Pemimpin spiritual Iran, Ayatullah Ruhollah Khomeini.
The number of restaurants that we could probably go out and enjoy in Jakarta was certainly didn't exceed the number of fingers you had on two hands. But that's not to say life was dull. So Sarah was born already established by then in Jakarta in 1986. So David started school in, I suppose, about 1985-86. His education went a slightly different way from Alex. We made a decision to move Alex from the British International School when he was 9 years old to the American system at the Jakarta International School, a much larger school with two campuses. Well, not before too long, we had two American children speaking with full American accents.
I broke my arm on this thing.
To our mild consternation and probably my parents' consternation back in the UK as we came home on leave with two American grandchildren.
Hi, Granny. Hi, Grandpa. I just turned 10 yesterday. This is my new racket.
Where's your wobbly tooth?
Here.
Right there. What are you going to do about it?
Take it out!
That notwithstanding, they enjoyed life tremendously. They got to, all of us learnt new experiences, new sports such as baseball and basketball, which both Alex and David grew to love. And we started spending our Saturday afternoons on running up and down touch lines. And when we did have the opportunity for leave, we would either take a break in Singapore or travel outside Indonesia, which either meant going back to the UK.
Or at my uncle's house, celebrating.
Uncle who?
Uncle Nippy.
Or by that time going to Australia. Gillian's parents had migrated to Australia from Malaysia already before we were even married. And so home for Gillian had become by default, in terms of where her parents were, Australia, and in particular Tasmania. And Alex, when he was reached the age of 13, we had a pivotal holiday in the United States.
Welcome to Holiday 1990,
a nightmare for travellers.
Those people who always wonder what the photographer looks like, I'm sorry to disappoint you.
Have I told you a million times to stop talking to yourself?
And we had, we went to the States for 3 or 4 weeks, hired a camper van, travelled around the Southwest.
What you're looking at now is Zion Park in southern Utah.
Also visited friends in Washington, D.C. And I very much thought that in the case of Alex and David, this was a homecoming. Deep down inside them, despite wherever their parents came from and despite the country they actually lived in, by that time they felt they were Americans. They'd been used to an American culture from 9 to 5. They spoke American, and here was their big opportunity to actually go to America. But once we got there, and I particularly remember Alex, and maybe David might have shared similar sentence to me, "This is one hell of a strange place, Dad. It's not what I expected at all." And the penny dropped with me that we had children who really didn't quite know where they were from or where they were going to and needed a firmer foundation. And we trawled for appropriate schools and till they came down with the choice of Bryanston, where my two brothers had been a generation before, as being the ideal school for Alex. And that eventually became the story for both David and Sarah. Meanwhile, parallel to that, of course, my own career was developing. I'd become a partner in Ernst & Young. Eventually, after a number of false starts, the right decision was made in 1995, and we created a brand new partnership in Ernst & Young in Jakarta, which enabled the firm to grow very rapidly. And within a few years, we had grown from being the smallest in what was known then as, I think it was the big six accounting firms of the world, represented in Indonesia, from being very much the sixth or even the eighth, because we were even smaller than some of our second tier competitors, to becoming number one and being the largest firm in Indonesia. So that was it was nice to see the firm grow in that time and me grow with it. One of the undoubted highlights of my career with Ernst & Young, albeit in the latter years, the last 5 or 6 years, was my initiative to establish what we call within Ernst & Young the Entrepreneur of the Year Business Award program. Before we established it in Indonesia, the award had gone global, which was presented and was in Monte Carlo. And so that was a great carrot for a winner and a very prestigious journey to take our winners on. So it was my privilege, together with Gillian, to take our national award winners every year to Monte Carlo and accompany them and their families and anybody else they wanted to invite. In the background, Indonesia was, as a country, was going through its own transformation and some of its most difficult years. 1997, 2 years after we'd made the new firm.
And that's the 14th of May, looking out my office window. As you can see, I think, enormous pools of smoke over large parts of North Jakarta. No doubt rioting mobs underneath them.
Suharto, who had been the dictator leader of Indonesia since 1965, resigned under enormous pressure. The word revolution was never used, but effectively it was a revolution was needed to get rid of him. And that around that there was a period of enormous uncertainty from a political and security point of view. And it was touch and go for several years after 1997-98, whether Indonesia would actually hold together as a single political entity.
The Indonesian police chief says 4 of the perpetrators died in the attack, 2 of them after detonating suicide bombs.
It would be a serious omission on my part if I didn't say something about terrorism in Indonesia, which has been in the background of our life in Indonesia since the mid-90s. From my own point of view, the closest to home was the bombing of the Jakarta Stock Exchange building where my office was. The next serious bombing incident was in Bali, which is probably still to this day well known as a major global terrorist incident. We were not in Bali at the time, but a number of friends of ours were. The second Bali bombing almost got a lot closer to us. The second Bali bombing was actually multiple bombs on 2 different beaches. Subsequently, there were a number of bombing incidents in Jakarta. Again, we knew people who were killed and injured in those bombing incidents, but thankfully, we weren't among them. I certainly found these incidents very upsetting at a personal level. One might ask, why did we continue to live in that environment? I suppose one of the answers to that were, what were the alternatives going to be? And a feeling that when your number is up, your number is up. So perhaps we adopted a fatalistic attitude, an attitude that we'd lived through the IRA bombs. Ginny had lived through the early days of the communist emergency in Malaysia. There have been various other incidents during our lives. We seem to be survivors rather than victims. One of the most rewarding aspects of my life in Indonesia, which originally came about almost by accident, I suppose, was the British Chamber of Commerce in Indonesia, which I, in its present form, I was the founding chairman of, but had also been involved in its predecessor organisations as a member, a board member, and and even chairman of the original Indonesian-British Association, which subsequently became the Indonesian-British Business Association, of which I was the first and only chairman, before we then formed the what is now and continues to be the British Chamber of Commerce in Indonesia. It eventually culminated, I guess, in me being awarded the OBE in the end of 2001 for services to British commercial interests, which really translates into being the founding chairman of the British Chamber. I finally retired rather later than other people might have done in the end of 2017. So we'd already effectively made a strategic decision that we would divide our lives between Indonesia in the shape of Bali and the UK in the shape of Dorset, Shaftesbury, and travelling using both those locations as a base for travelling wider in the areas in which they are. If I could advise future generations, what would I talk about? Well, I suppose without going into anything particular, one piece of advice I would give is probably to listen and heed the advice of people much older than themselves. I guess, you know, if I looked at myself, one thing I would say I'm probably, I'm not sure it's a curse or an attribute, is probably dogged determination, loyalty. Gillian might say sometimes misplaced, sometimes I might even agree with her.